Welcome to you all, and so for tonight we will have for tonight we have an interesting topic. I think it's part of my own research, and it has to do with the interplay between Judaism, Islam, and Christianity. But it is a field that is not very known. Of course, the biblical stories are known to everybody, but the way these biblical stories are dealt with are quite mysterious and challenging also. And so we have to attune ourselves a bit to a new approach to the biblical figures. For example, Abraham, or Ibrahim as he is called in Islam, can be considered as one of the towering spiritual figures of our history, comparable to Socrates or Plato. And in fact, even the comparison can be pushed a bit further, because in those stories about Abraham, it is told that already as a boy he was searching for the truth, he was searching for the invisible God. And he doubted that the idols which were sold in his father's shop, that they were the real gods. And maybe you know the story about that Azar or Terach, he goes away and he says to his son Abraham, he says, take care of the shop. And Abraham is thinking, and he thinks, well, these are just idols, you know what, I smashed them all. Except the biggest one. And the father comes back and says, what has happened? Everything is ruined. And then he says, well, they go fight, and the biggest smashed all the others. And then his father said, that's impossible, because they are just dolls and they cannot do anything. And then, of course, the young Abraham says, see, now you say it yourself, they cannot do anything. So this story is, in fact, you may say, the beginning of monotheist religion. So that means that there is an element of violence in the story. There is an element of maybe intolerance, but also an element of searching for the truth and being prepared to even to leave your birth land and your family behind to go on the way, as Abraham did. So the story is of course not biblical as such, but you can realize that when Genesis 12 starts to talk about Abraham, that the oral traditions are wondering what happened before that. Was it all of a sudden that Abraham got to hear the message go out, and then go out from Ur Kasdim, which can be translated as the fire of the Chaldees, and this then can also give the tradition of that Abraham was in fact thrown in a fiery oven by Nimrod, and Nimrod is a tyrant who thought about himself that he was God. So what is the parallel between this story and Socrates and Plato? Well, in a way, there is a story that Abraham as a boy sits in a cave and contemplates the stars and is impressed by the stars, that this is our God. But then he sees that the stars wane, that they become less clear because of the moon, and then he says, well, the moon is then our God. But then the moon disappears and he sees the sun, and then he is glad because now I've seen this is the real God. But then it becomes dark again, and then he decides that all these visible elements cannot be the real God. So it's interesting that he's in a cave and that he gets his enlightenment in a cave, which of course reminds us then of Plato's story of the cave and also of the real truth, the light that is discovered by those who don't want to be satisfied with shadows only. And as Socrates said, the most important thing is to know yourself. We may see Abraham as the one who discovered that the most important thing is to discover the other, to discover God, and to see your whole life in that perspective. An important difference between the Islamic approach to Abraham and, let's say, the Jewish or the Christian, Eastern Christian approach, it's quite vital that the Islamic approach speaks about the infallibility of the prophet. That means that they consider all prophets, of course Muhammad also, but also the other biblical prophets, they consider them as kind of totally saintly and perfect figures. And this is not the case with the Bible, as is obvious. For look at this picture. I just took this picture because it's Gustave Doré, and you know Gustave Doré is in it's Romanticism, and Romanticism is always very good in identifying with the marginalized and with the persecuted and with the one who loses. And here you see how Hagar and Ishmael are sent away. We will see that Islam has a completely different perspective of Abraham, and this is also the reason that Islam has developed the idea of tahrif. Tahrif means corruption, and tahrif means the idea that the Bible contains falsifications, that it's wrong text, and that the Quran was necessary to correct the wrong readings of the Bible. And this is especially developed because of what is said in Islamic sources, the unworthy behavior of biblical figures, including Abraham. So they assume that the way the Bible describes Abraham is not exactly correct. Well, we will see that that it's not something that Muslims will accept, but I will demonstrate that it is the case, that there is a strong influence of Jewish sources upon the Islamic idea of Abraham. But what, of course, is most surprising, and I will deal with it with you with the sources, so I will distribute a handout with the sources, but what is most surprising is that Hagar in Islam is in fact the first to perform the Hajj, the first to do the pilgrimage to Mecca. And in Mecca you have to run between two hills, and the running between the two hills is described in Islamic sources as Hagar who searches for water. She nearly dies from thirst, and especially for her boy Ishmael. And the searching for water causes that she runs seven times to and fro the two hills. And this is an essential part of the Hajj. Another essential part of the Hajj is the drinking from the source, Zamzam. And this is the source that more or less is described also in the Bible. Because, as you know, when Hagar has been expelled, she is held by an angel and is offered to drink. Well, how these stories tie in each other, we will search in a more specific way.